Well, good afternoon, colleagues and friends. Thank you so much to those of you who've come in person and for physically distancing very nicely. And of course, a very warm welcome to our colleagues who are joining us on the live stream today from right across the country. Welcome to this special edition of the Queensland Conservatorium Research Centre's Behind the Music, where we'll be exploring what the March for Justice movement means for the music industry. My name is Brydie Bartleet, and I have the great pleasure of serving as the director of the Queensland Conservatorium Research Centre here at Griffith University. I'd like to begin this afternoon's proceedings by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the land upon which we're gathered this afternoon, the Jagera and Turrbal peoples, and pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging, and extend that respect to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander colleagues as our contributors and audience here today. So last month, tens of thousands of people turned out to marches across Australia, protesting against the sexual abuse and harassment of women in this country. While these marches were prompted by a recent wave of sexual assault allegations centred around the Australian Parliament, they point towards much larger systemic issues and the need for greater equality, justice, respect, and fairness across all Australian sectors and communities. And today we're going to be discussing what this means for the music industry. Right at the very outset, we recognise the need to have an intersectional mindset when addressing these issues, and we acknowledge the importance of gender diversity and inclusivity when broaching these topics. We also recognise at the outset that for some of you joining us today, the content might raise some issues for you. So on screen we have some numbers you can call, and we'll share these at the end of the session again. But we want music to be present in this conversation, and we want music to have the first and the last word. So it is my very great pleasure now to welcome Louise King and Christa Powell from Muses Trio, two-thirds of the Muses Trio today. As you might well know, Muses Trio celebrate music composed by women, performed by women, and focus on bringing the sometimes unknown, yet of course vastly important repertoire to the stage. And they're going to be performing Kate Moore's Whoever You Are, Come Forth, and Rebecca Clark's Lullaby. Please make them most welcome. Thank you so much, Louise and Christa, for such a stirring and beautiful opening to our event, and for all that you and the Muses Trio do to make our music industry more gender inclusive. Thank you. Another round of applause for our wonderful musicians. It's now my great pleasure, while we change over roles here, to introduce this fabulous panellist. Next to me here, Professor Sue Harris-Rimmer, who is the director of Griffith's Policy Innovation Hub and a very well-known gender scholar and human rights expert. Thank you so much for joining us today, Sue. Vanessa Tomlinson, Professor Vanessa Tomlinson, needs very little introduction in this hall, of course, very well known within the con as a percussionist, an artistic director, an academic, a composer, and deputy director of the Queensland Conservatorium Research Centre. Welcome to Vanessa. Also, another person who needs little introduction, Dr Charulatha Mani, who is the centre manager of the QCRC, but also a researcher and very well known and renowned Carnatic singer who had an illustrious career in Chennai for a couple of decades before moving to Australia. So welcome, Charu. And joining us is Christa Powell as our fourth panellist. Christa, thank you for so graciously stepping in. We've worked her today. She's not only performing but also joining us as a panellist. So thank you so much for stepping in. And you might know her as the creative director of Topology, but also one third of the Muses Trio who we heard from today. And also an alumni of the con, which is great to celebrate as well. We were due to have Associate Professor Naomi Sunderland joining us, who is a Discovery Australian Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Award Research Fellow, singer, songwriter and facilitator teacher, but sadly due to an injury she's not able to be with us in person, but she has sent a video, so we're going to share that in a little while. Now on screen, if you can see from where you're seated, we have an image of the March for Justice protests in Brisbane last month, and some of you might have even been there. Sue, can I turn to you first and just ask you, what was your absolute gut reaction to seeing footage of these marches right across the country and to hearing the revelations that were coming out of Canberra and, quite honestly, are continuing to come out of Canberra? What was your gut reaction?
I mean, I tend to exist on a diet of rage anyway, as someone who does gender policy. I was at the Brisbane March, and I suppose this, for those of us who were already following gender and politics very closely, I suppose it was depressingly familiar. But the scale of the issues, I'd kind of known about the Christian Porter issue for years, actually, and I'd heard about the Brittany Higgins affair, and I'd heard about some of the other issues. So that's in the Canberra bubble, I used to work in Parliament, in the Canberra bubble, as they call it, some of these issues were talked about or on the margins or whispered about. You know, certainly when you worked in Parliament, you knew, you were told by other women who to avoid and all those kinds of things. But the sort of the depth of structural problems were even beyond my understanding, and the fact that they were all revealed in this snowball, one after another after another, part of me was deeply relieved that finally these issues were being aired and having a moment of sunshine and transparency, and that everyone would understand how flawed our parliament is, that's meant to be making laws about gendered workplaces and itself is not a safe workplace. You all know that now, and that is a step forward, right? But that kind of visceral anger that so many of these women felt and feel, and men, you know, men and women who are just fed up with the kinds of lives we're expected to lead that are so unfair based on such discriminatory attitudes and boxes around how people can be judged and treated, and the structural inequality built into public life. I felt it was a different feeling. I felt it around Black Lives Matters protests as well. I feel like we are getting somewhere. There's a feeling of general acceptance that these things have got to change. And then the kind of to use lots of musical metaphors, there have been lots of musical metaphors around what's happening in Queensland and federal politics, and the tone deaf responses is the word that most of the media uses. And it is absolutely, literally tone deaf, isn't it? Just being unable to listen, unable to respond to the way people are feeling. So yes, I feel both deeply relieved that we're having what I hope is a transformational moment, and I'm terrified that it won't be. So
I think that's something we are all concerned about. We're so hoping that this time it might be the tipping point. I know I watched and I thought, have we finally reached the tipping point? Because these are not new issues, but it gives me hope that you feel that there's something different in the air. Vanessa, can I turn to you? So Sue's talked about the relief of seeing the snowball of revelations, but also the constant rage. What was your gut reaction to what you were seeing?
I think for me it was sadness. Sadness of all the times people have come forward and risked something to express their situation and been ignored. And just the amount of cycles that's gone through. There was both rage and happiness that there's a collective action, and that was cathartic to feel like we were together in this. But I guess it's that endless frustration of the risk people personally go through for themselves to actually say something, and the amount of silencing that has been pushed their way. It's so deep. There's so many buckets of silence. There's so many things we can't see, absences of knowledge, that I found that just really, really depressing. And that some people, through media, were exposed to say, oh, I didn't realise the extent of the problem. That just blew my brain. Mm. Like you talk about tone deaf. That was a revelation. Yeah. How can you not have known that this is there? I think everyone in this room has experience, has knowledge, has empathy. That just blew my brain that you could actually say that. So, great deep sadness.
Yeah. Lucky there's empathy training.
Yes, we should probably have information about courses on empathy training, but I relate to your silence and also the sense that how can people be so surprised and shocked? To me, that was shocking in and of itself, because that says a lot. But also those pockets of silence. It makes me think of the New Australian of the Year, Grace Tame, speaking so eloquently about how evil lives in silence. And in silence, evil can be perpetuated. So I want to come back to this idea of voicing and listening a bit later. Thank you, Vanessa. Charu, did you have a similar reaction to the others when you saw what was happening? Bearing in mind your interesting experience both in Chennai here and in Australia.
So I'm a recent migrant, Brydie, as you know. And so this took me back straight to the problems back home in India with women and silencing, and their prominent people have been even murdered. And without a second thought, there's not been much discussion. So the silence has perpetuated that evil, unquestioned evil. But I kind of looked up the definition, I mean the meaning of the word groundswell, and what I read was really deeply impactful. So what the meaning that I came across was it's a deep and a broad undulation of the ocean bed. And I was thinking that if our collective patience is an ocean bed, how much of aggravation has caused this seismic scale of undulation to come forth, and how people are boiling, but still we remain cool because we're civilized. And that's the reason there's been an orderly protest. There hasn't been anarchy.
That's a beautiful metaphor. I think we've all very much related to that swelling of the ocean and what it's actually taken to reach that point. Thank you, Charu. Christa? How do you react to these issues from where you stand?
Yeah, well, I've been through the whole, like everybody, I'm sure, the whole spectrum of emotions, like, you know, very excited and hopeful and sad. But there's a corner of me that's just the hopelessness I feel and that I don't want to admit to, you know, because it has been around for so long. And, you know, I guess before I started with Muses 10 years ago, I probably was more ignorant about how long this really has been going on for, because we've been discovering composers and musicians, female, going back hundreds of years, and reading their stories is just heart-wrenching, you know. And I feel like, well, is anything really going to change? And then, you know, also other people's reactions, especially in, I guess, the next generation up from all of us is the excuses and, you know, little tiny comments that are just sort of accepted and, yeah, so.
Yeah. I think there's great power in those little tiny comments which actually accumulate and add up to a lot. And those little tiny actions that can fall beneath the radar that actually add up to be quite seismic. That makes a nice segue to us thinking a bit more specifically about music. And I want to zoom in now on thinking about the music industry. Up on screen, there's the image of a report which was released in 2017 called Skipping a Beat, Assessing the State of Gender Equality in the Australian Music Industry, done by Ray Cooper, Amanda Coles and Sally Hannah Osborne, where they show that male advantage is pervasive in the Australian music industry. Most notably, their data demonstrates how male dominance is seen in the key decision-making roles that shape the industry norms, importantly the industry values and practices. And I think touching on my opening remarks about the importance of an intersectional mindset and thinking about this in terms of gender diversity, they also show that even less recognition and power is afforded to minority groups of women, such as First Nations, and culturally and linguistically diverse women, women with disabilities, and those identifying as non-binary or gender diverse. Also of relevance to this discussion in 2017, the Australian-led hashtag MeNoMore movement published an open letter to the music industry signed by well over 1,000 musicians. Some of you may have read the really gut-wrenching testimonials that were part of this open letter. They are horrific. They share blood-curdling stories, gendered stories of sexism, misogyny, sexual harassment, assault, and rape, which have largely been ignored by the music industry. So to add to this conversation now, I want to bring in the voice of a very dear colleague and friend of ours who has long championed the need to address these issues in our industry, Professor Kat Hope. Kat is a multi-award-winning composer, sound artist and musician, and a leading academic from Monash University. And I want to bring her voice into the mix before I ask the panel for their reflections.
Hi, it's Kat Hope here. Thanks so much for asking me to send a message. It's so great you're coming together and gathering at this time, really bouncing off the energy created by the March for Justice. Look, I'm a firm believer in enough is enough, and these problems that are being highlighted in the highest office of our land, Parliament, are not unique to that place. In fact, they're everywhere, and the music industry is no exception. In 2015, Music Victoria did a survey of women audiences and musicians in venues across that state and found that over 80% of women had experienced some form of sexual harassment or assault. That's way too high for any industry, and nothing is being done. It's time for change. It's time for us to take stock, look at the efforts of the past, see how we can build and improve on them to have a more inclusive, more powerful women's movement that can make real change, real lasting change, not just for us, but for those who come after us. Enough is enough. Let's get together, let's make the most of the interest in this subject and really change the music industry to be a much more inclusive workplace for everyone, forever.
Well said, Kat, and we send our love out to you, hopefully watching the live stream in Melbourne. Vanessa, I'm going to turn to you as a close colleague of Kat's. She flags, of course, that the music industry is not immune to the issues we've seen in the Australian Parliament. And she also talks about really capitalising on this energy, this interest and this movement now for broader change in the music industry. From your perspective, what do you think this March for Justice groundswell really means for the music industry? Is it relevant? And if it is, how?
Oh, Brydie, this is such a big question. I don't have a simple answer to that. And of course, this is relevant to the music industry. I'm about to turn 50. I've been in the music industry for almost 35 years. I started as a professional at 15. And I feel like the whole time, it's like learning to play Mario Kart or something. I have to learn how to avoid obstacles. The whole time. I'm just like, and I'm getting better and better at navigating past those things. So there's a misogynist piece of shit there. I can work out how to get around that really eloquently now. So for me, I'm kind of okay. But I feel that I'm passing on this knowledge to the next generation. Yeah. And it's that intergenerational transference of my skill of avoidance which I'm really, really concerned about now. And I've just started reflecting on it, and I think the March for Justice has helped propel that rethinking and going, maybe I should not be silencing the problem and not be avoiding the object. I should actually be ramming straight ahead into the object. And that's a big change, especially when one works in an institution and there's all kinds of protocols and hierarchies and things that... I guess the entrenched silence that one needs in order to operate in an environment. And so it's kind of these different speeds that we have to work at as musicians. So there's that side, but there's another side that I'm just endlessly concerned about, which is power imbalance. And that gets brought to the fore in music through the transferal of information from teacher to student, which often happens behind closed doors, which often happens in these one-to-one situations, which gets sort of cemented when one meets out in public because we're all in the same scene, and so relationships get complicated in the social scene to do with what's happening in the private one-to-one teaching scene. Sorry, I'm speaking in very broad terms here because it's a very difficult subject to really approach. Mm-hmm. And I think that so much has been swept under the carpet in these little boxes that happen in any music institution. And for anyone that has experienced that, I'm really sorry. And I know that that's been experienced on my watch, and I'm really sorry. And I think we have to be sorry. Like, the collective, very large, we have to be sorry and have to find ways of reconciliation with that. You know, there's people that I know won't walk into certain buildings because of their experiences in the music industry to do with people that have happened in that particular scenario. There's people who have given up music because of that. There's people who whose career they know they has only been navigated because they have submitted to that, whatever that may be. And these are really, really, really problematic issues. I feel relatively happy that we have turned a corner in this, by the way. I feel like so much has been done, there is so much public display that really being ignorant anymore is impossible. I feel that we're better listeners, but I don't think we're happily at a spot where everyone feels safe learning music and being a musician. And that's, I'm just really sorry about that.
Absolutely, Vanessa. And I want to pick up on your comment about the importance of listening, but when you first started talking, it also reminded me of how patriarchy requires us to discipline ourselves and to teach to our students that process of disciplining as well. And when I first ventured into feminist studies 20-odd years ago and was reading the likes of Judith Butler and started to realise how I was disciplining my body as a conductor when I chose my clothes to wear, how I operated on stage, it really was a really compelling realisation of what I was doing and then teaching students in turn to do. But I want to pick up on your point of listening, and there's a picture on screen right now which really speaks to the importance, I'm going to skip to that, thanks Matt, of listening. And I think as we've seen in the recent protests, the right to be heard and calls to listen, like Vanessa has just said, have been really identified as central to addressing ongoing injustices and gender inequalities. And we've seen really powerful ways of people sharing their stories and their testimonies via digital platforms. While politicians say they're listening, I think it would be fair to say, as Sue was suggesting, that public trust in the process of consultation and representation is minimal. And we are hearing that many people are coming forward and sharing stories that are just being ignored or people are refusing to listen. There's a really interesting book by Leah Bassell called The Politics of Listening that I think is really interesting to reflect on here, which argues that listening is a social and political practice in contrast to the more common focus on voice and speaking. This book considers whether and how a politics of listening, which demands that the roles of speaker and listeners change, can be undertaken in these sorts of movements we're talking about here. It shifts responsibility for change from marginalised voices onto the institutions, practices and norms that perpetuate inequalities. So to add to this conversation, I'm now going to share a brief video from our fifth panellist who was due to be with us today, Naomi Sunderland, to reflect on the importance of this.
One big important thing is, over the years, probably really a culmination of about 20 years of music making, songwriting, and research across these different areas has led me to really acknowledge the importance of working anti-oppressively, but also acknowledging the ways that oppression often leads to trauma for big collections, big groupings of people. And that oppression and the trauma that's related to that is often experienced intergenerationally. I think there's a number of things that we can do in response to this. The biggest thing is around coming to understand the nature of people's experiences, of trying to listen with an open heart in a non-defensive and humble way to other people's experiences, and using whatever spheres of influence that we have to help others to lead the change that they would like to see in the music industry and surrounding support institutions.
Thank you so much to Naomi. Charu, I'm going to turn to you now. So Naomi talks about the importance of working anti-oppressively and the way in which listening can be a way to engage with the trauma that's being caused by oppression, but also the importance of listening with an open heart, an open mind, non-defensiveness and in a humble way. I know this has been an important part of the work that you've done. How can the music industry better engage in this politics of listening to inform how it responds to this current moment in time?
I think as musicians, we we operate on a couple of levels, on an emotional level and a physical level. And both these levels are being manipulated and coerced in this context. So I think the listening must be, it must be overt, it must be explicit, but also implicit understanding and listening to what's not being said. I think it's very important. Because not everybody expresses themselves eloquently. I mean, not least people who are marginalized, those who cannot speak clearly for themselves, or those who have been silenced systemically, and the trauma resides in the body. So I think the listening, Brydie, has to happen on several levels here. And we were talking about empathy earlier, so I think an empathy has to precede listening. So there's an activity, but also this that pre-work that I think we need to engage in.
Absolutely. I love your idea of listening on many levels, and that reminds us, of course, of Dadiri and the important deep listening, and wonderful that that's been acknowledged by Auntie Miriam Rose in terms of Australian Senior Australian of the Year. And listening on many levels, but then responding, and also recognising that marginalised voices are not always going to be able to speak because it's not a safe space to speak, as Vanessa said before. Sue, in terms of these politics of listening, what would your advice be to the music industry from your much broader perspective in terms of human rights and what can come from deep political listening?
I think we also have to think about these structures. So if you think about this year, politically speaking, you also had a federal budget, the big COVID budget, that comprehensively did not respond to the lived experience of women during COVID. You know, so it didn't put enough aside for many industries that were mostly affected, including the creative arts. So we keep having to also interrogate what people are actually saying. We care about women's lives. Well, why your budget does not demonstrate that. We care about women's representation. Well, your cabinet doesn't demonstrate that. We care about a rigorous gender analysis of all kinds of policies. Prove it. You know. So I think we have to keep... I'm very interested in listening, but I'm also very interested in interrogating what's said and the evidence behind it. So, you know, if you think about the way the creative industries have been treated during COVID, it's disgusting. It shows a level of disrespect for the importance of what do we all need during lockdown? What do we all do? We were listening to music. We were trying to seek comfort in beautiful movies that we love. Or, you know, we all turn to the creative arts for comfort and solace and feelings of collective nurturing. You know, it was overwhelming. Like, the stats coming out are overwhelming. That's what people did in COVID. You know, they tried to seek solace through the creative arts. And what did we do to the creative arts? It's really quite interesting. So I feel like this empathetic listening has got to come with our ability to increase our ability to hold people to account, or constantly give the counter narrative. If you cared about the counter-narrative or the critique, you wouldn't silence the universities and ruin universities. You wouldn't ruin the creative arts. And, you know, for creative arts centres within universities, it's been the double-barreled punch, you know. So I feel like, and it's the same with First Nations issues, you know, where is the evidence that the rhetoric is going to match the reality at any point soon? So we have to keep... have to keep being really brave about this and calling it out. And I agree. I feel like to watch the bravery of this next generation of women and girls who are calling out climate change, calling out sexual violence, and I feel like such a failure that they have had to take this on. We should have been able to make sure their experience was different to ours, and somehow we have not. We failed on almost every intergenerational equity goal you can think of. The feminist movement's in mourning, you know, and it's not for, and I've got to tell you, it wasn't for lack of trying, but it wasn't intersectional enough, it wasn't powerful enough, it wasn't critical enough of sort of neoliberalism, and it just wasn't enough. So we've got to kind of be honest with ourselves too. I think you kind of think, if I'm on the side that's trying, that's enough. It's not enough. Yeah. So it's about, I think, thinking about what will I sacrifice and what will I risk. And these are difficult considerations, but I think for all of us, we are in a privileged position globally, and within Australia, all of us. So it's about what risks are we going to take.
Well said, Sue. I think that's a really good call to action for everyone in this room in terms of reflecting on what each and every one of us can do, and also the responsibility that comes with listening. There's no point in hollow listening that goes nowhere, but as you said, deep empathetic listening that actually then is propelled to action is what we need. I'm going to flick to the next image on screen, which speaks to the point that Sue's just made about this not being a new issue, and that there have been many waves of feminism. There have been people like this woman in the wheelchair on screen who've been fighting every single decade, and she's still here in 2021. I think that really encapsulates that this, you could say, gender inequality is a wicked problem. And each of the different waves of feminism have tried to tackle different dimensions of it, whether it's around voting, whether it's around equal pay, whether it's around the issues that we're grappling with at the moment now. But it begs the question, what can we do now in this day and age, in this time and place? How do we really make the most of the energy and the movement that's been coming? From my own observations, having researched in this space for over 20 years in terms of women's experiences in the music industry, largely conductors, I've seen over those 20 years more women ascending the podium, which has been great, but my fear is that it's what my dear doctoral supervisor Liz McKinley called the add and stir method, where you just keep adding more women, and that's great, but you're not actually changing the recipe, you're not changing the structures, you're not really dealing with this on a systemic level. And I hope that what we're feeling now might be something towards a more systemic addressing of this issue. But for this last little couple of minutes of the conversation, I want us to actually think about those next steps and what we can do today that might lead to some degree of lasting change. And I've got one last excerpt I'd like to play from Dr. Catherine Strong from RMIT, who's one of the most active Australian scholars currently researching gender in popular music, and a very well-known and well-respected activist as well. So we're going to have a few words from Catherine on what can be done and what is being done.
In terms of what sort of things we can do, there have been some really good innovations around the place in terms of actual, like, formal training. So there's a program called Access All Areas here in Melbourne that is about bystander training, so teaching people how to intervene when they see things going wrong in music spaces. There's also things like the Safer Spaces initiative, which is about going into venues and teaching venue staff and venue owners and security as well about what it is and isn't appropriate, and again, how they can respond appropriately if something does go wrong. I mean, these things aren't magic bullets, but they are a really good way of putting the conversation sort of front and center and bringing the conversation to the people who are going to be the ones who do have to respond when things do happen, the ones who are going to be faced with the decision-making around, do I eject this man from the venue because this woman has said that he touched her inappropriately, and do I eject her at the same time, which is something that has happened in the past. So, yeah, it's just about keeping the conversation going as much as possible. Because one of the things that we know happens with these things is they get publicity for a while, people get outraged, people share their stories, there's like a sense that something could change, but then often it all sort of drifts into the background again, and we come back in a few years and have the same conversation. And how we break that cycle, I mean, it's really hard, and obviously there are a lot of people who have vested interests in not breaking that cycle. But I think it can be done, and conversations, just not letting things slide, not letting it fall by the wayside, educating younger women as well, like as new people come into the music industry, not letting them just sort of drift in and have to experience these things, but finding a way to keep it in the foreground of people's minds, I think, is really important. Yeah, it's hard work though.
Thank you. Thank you, Catherine, and for her continual advocacy as well. Christa, I'm going to turn to you. So Catherine talks about some of the programs that are currently running and talks about the importance of constantly keeping the conversation going, which is kind of what Muses Trio is doing. And she also talks about the importance of educating young musicians, which is something I know you've been involved with in your role with Topology.
Yeah.
What sorts of strategies, practical strategies, do you think we could be doing that will have a long-term impact in this area?
Well, I think my my immediate, I guess, instinctive reaction is to look into myself and how, you know, like your Mario Kart analogy, but at what point did you realise you were avoiding things, and at what point, because I know myself that there was probably a long time where I was just absorbing it all without really being aware of what was going on, and it's only now I'm looking back, and so I start to think, hey, we educate women, we talk, we advocate for women, but why are we always turning to change our behaviour or to make ourselves better when really, I mean, I don't have an answer to how we educate men. You know, I'm doing it as best I can with the men in my life, my son and, you know, the men around me. My father, you know, he's not too old to be educated at 86 because he says some really alarming things, you know, which is just ingrained in his generation. So I think it's all of that. It's yes, still advocate and educate young women, but it's also, do you push through those barriers? Do you charge into them? I still don't know what the, do you make a noise? Do you make a, you know, what do you think?
I'm really sick of making a scene.
Yes, exactly. As well.
And so for everyone in this room that, or that's listening online, you know, it's all of our jobs to make sure that every concert has equity in the music that's on that program. It's not my job. And I don't have to be the voice at a committee that says, hey, by the way, can we just check the gender balance? Like, it's all of our job. It should just be an internal thing that happens. And thank you to those people in the room that have reminded me on occasions of that problem. It's like all of these things are all of our problem. And I think that's when we'll start to get the traction, when we're all checking each other. And not in a critical way, just like, oh, hey, Christa, did you realise you did that concert of all guys on that thing? Yeah. Would you like to, like, balance that on the next concert? Yeah, actually, it's a good idea. Here's some ideas. So the thing that we're working collectively to an outcome, I think, would be great, and it would lessen the burden on individuals. And that's the thing, I've been doing it in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, et cetera, et cetera. It gets really tiring. And you get sort of sick of your own voice, and you get stuck on the same things that you're saying. So let's all just do that. Let's all just be proactive. And I love what she was saying about the security guards, the back of stage people, all having training in how to intervene and act. We all are responsible to intervene and act. We've had bystander training here at the con, and it was great. Just feeling confident to go in and say, hey, I just want to call this out. That's all of our job, and if we all do it, it's not a burden, but if it's one person.
And that comes back also to the power imbalance too, is also, and I would really try this, so we don't use the word education in our education program because already the connotations is power imbalance, and so it's really about augmenting ourselves with younger musicians, and it's augmenting their skills with our experience, and, you know, so I think it is semantics, and it's just how it can happen in everything you say and everything, and you can pick up, and also so younger people don't feel judged if they say something, you know, if they feel with another tutor or, you know, something happens, they feel like they can come to any of the experts, I suppose, or the tutors, or, you know.
Indeed.
But we really try to get rid of that power imbalance. Yep. And everything.
Great insights there, and I think a really nice way to finish this conversation in terms of that collective action, right from the students that you're working alongside up to the 86-year-old dad, and recognising as well from the bouncer at the door to the musicians on stage, to those who are producing, presenting, there's a role for everybody. It can't just fall to one or two who are very tired of being continually raged by what's happening.
Can I add just one point? I teach policy students the idea that you need to blue sky things sometimes too. So use all these amazing creative imaginary skills we have to think to ourselves, if we accept the premise that all human beings can produce and appreciate music equally, what would the music industry look like? Like, really think about, because a lot of what we're talking about is how to overcome negative challenges, but we also need that positive vision of what we're aiming for. Like, I tell people, what would a hospital look like if it was truly gender equal? What would a university look like? What would an army look like? Like, got to keep thinking about, what are we aiming for here?
What would the music industry sound like?
What would it sound like?
Yeah. I think I could not have asked for a better moment to pause on. What would the music industry sound like? I love the way that that's working from a strengths-based, blue sky, visionary way of thinking of things, rather than us working from a deficit model, which, as we know, can only get us so far. So I think that's wonderful food for thought and a wonderful challenge to each of us panelists, to those listening on the live stream, and to each and every one of you who've been gracious enough to come and join us today. Now, this has been a conversation that has only been a starter, a taste tester, but it's an important one that we've wanted to have here at the Conservatorium, and we hope that it's going to continue. So thank you so much to our fabulous panellists who've really been very generous and I think very inspiring and thought-provoking in what you've shared. Thank you. Now, To bring this conversation to a close, I promised that music would have the first and last word, and it's my very great pleasure to welcome to the stage Jo Davie, a graduate of the Con and multi-award winner and regular at many festivals. She's going to be singing an original, Brave We Can Be, and this will be a beautiful moment of reflection for us all to think about what's been shared today and what it might mean for all of us individually. So would you please join us in making Jo most welcome.
What it's done to me.
just a sad, sad shame to lose this game. And we'll soon see how brave. Thank you so much, Jo, for a hope-filled reminder of how brave we can be and how strong we can be. What a beautiful and moving and fitting way to close this conversation. Would you please join me in thanking once again our panelists, of course, Sue, Christa, Vanessa, and Charu for your wonderful insights, our performers, Louise, Christa, and Jo, colleagues who sent messages from far and wide, Kat, Naomi, and Catherine, our back and front of house crew who've assisted us today, Matt for operating the slides so beautifully, to Kai for working our live stream, Kali for documenting us in photos, Owen and the sound team for making us all sound very good, and a special thanks to Charu, who's also played such a key organisational role as well as being such a fabulous panellist as well. Thank you so much to you, our audience who've joined us here in person and our audience who've joined us on the live stream, for being part of this important conversation, for showing your support. Let's keep the conversation going, because enough is enough. Thank you.